you should still be getting signal. I just thought, well, I'm just on the camera.
Ready? Push for them to prove. Again, don't let leg.
Done in vain. He Kulanya, Basti, Kulanya. Saladet. He's back at Gollum with a fist. Kulanya, dear. He goes in by day, goes in by night. Goes in on land, he goes in on sea. Goes not by animal, goes not by man. He was killed by this supreme personality. Follow the law! Chanting, chanting, chanting the name of the Lord. 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 Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Gaur Vrindavan Ki Jai, Sala Maharaj Ki Jai.
Naam Budhi Prabhu Aayatam.
Jai Radha, Jai
ज्ञान तिरंभस्य ज्ञानं जनसलाकया चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः अन्तःकल्पतरुभ्यश्च पितासिन्धुभ्य एव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः नमो महावदन्याय कृष्णप्रेमप्रदायते कृष्णाय कृष्णचैतन्य नाम्ने गौरत्विषे नमः गुरवे गौरचन्द्राय राधिकायै सदालयै कृष्णाय कृष्णभक्ताय सर्वभक्ताय नमो नमः यं प्रभृजन्तमन्ते समचेतकृत्यम् दैपायनो विरहकासर्यायुराव पुत्रेति तन्मयतया सर्वोऽभिनेदो तं सर्वभूतहृदयं मुनिमानुत त्वयैवास्मि न दिवामि तया विना इति विज्ञाय राधे तन्मय मां शरणन्ति First of all, I could put the Dandot Kalam and the Lotus Feet of my spiritual master, Nitya Lila Prasad and Vishnu Krishna and Bhakti Pradhyan, Kesava Goswami Maharaj. And say, Koti Koti Dandot Kalam and the Lotus Feet of my Shiksha Guru,
that they could be liberated from the suffering. What is Kriya? All this activity, if it is done for Krishna, to please Krishna, then they are bhakti. Otherwise, not bhakti. Also, in Srimad Bhagavati, it has been told, Samai Parasana, Samai Purusan, Paro Dharma, Japo Bhakti Vadukhaye, Ahetukya, Bhaktavahita, Yabhakti Purushottama. Here, he has told two things. One, Swarupa Lakshan and other, Tatastha Lakshan. Swarupa Lakshan means?
Udidi. If it shakes and the head goes off, so that's the reason I did. Because it shakes, you know, without the tripod. So.
Then?
What is it
true? What is Param Dharma?
Hotel.
No, in the car.
Paramdharma means yes, most highest, supreme dharma of jeev. So by puntan, paro dharma, here puntan means ladies, men, creatures, pasu, pakshi, jeev, patan, all sahab kubarga. They had right to do bhajan. So, Savai Puntan Parodham. So then this is only one method.
Can you go on TV?
No other.
Can we see how different it is?
That is why she has told, Savai Nishyarthi.
But the sound is not coming.
So, definitely. And other time, no way. Savai Puntan Parodharmo Jato Bhakti Adhokhari. Supreme Lord who is not in in peaceful by mind, eyes, avan manaso gochara jyotu,
adhokshaya.
A prajna Krishna, his service without any worldly gain.
Can you tell him to read the sound from the phone conference?
But Srila Rupa Goswami, he had learned from Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, himself Krishna, and Radhika, both combined, and he made a very, very physical definition of bhakti. What is that? Anya Abhilashita Sanya. Jnan Karma Jnanat Vritam Anukulle Krishna Nidhanam Bhakti Rusana. You should all try to note its meaning, hear its meaning, and engage yourself in that kind of bhakti. You should tell the meaning. That Vishwanath Chakrabarti Thakur has done.
गुरुवे गौरचंदाय राधिकाय जलाले कृष्णाय कृष्णवत्साय सर्वत्साय नमो नमः. So this verse is described to be the Pali Bhasha, the definition verse of the Srimad Bhagavatam. Savaipur sam parodharma yathir bhakti yadopuje ahojiki apatiyati yanatma sam prasidati. So Guru Maharaj was just explaining, Srila Goswami says savai. Savai is definitely, not many could be perhaps, it's survival or anyabhilas. Anyabhilas tatsunyam jnana karmali nabhitam anakulena krishna nusilanam. So Sri Rupa Goswami, there are many different definitions of bhakti that have been given. For example, survival, iswaratat anurakta, the supreme absorption in the Absolute Lord is called bhakti. Also it's been described Saru Parivanir Muktam Tattara Tapena Nimalam Rishi Kena Rishi Kesa Sevanam Bhakti Vishate has also been described in other places. What is the definition of devotion? That when the living entity, the soul becomes free from his material attachment or his material identity and with his spiritual senses engages in the sense, in the service of the senses of the Supreme Lord, this has also been described to be called bhakti. Isti Swarisika Raga Parama Veshita Tata. Absorption in the Supreme Lord is also given as one definition of devotion. Yet, Sri Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur has said, despite the many definitions of devotion that are given in Shastra, that Sri Rupa Goswami has given the topmost benediction, topmost definition of devotion. What you can find in other definitions are also included in Rupa Goswami's Anya Vilasita Sunyam. But Rupa Goswami has given something which has not been given in other verses. Therefore this has been given by Sri Rupa Goswami in his book, Sri Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu. So there he has said, Anya Vilasita. First, there is the intrinsic qualities of devotion, or the internal characteristics of devotion. He's also given two symptoms that are externally associated with devotion. So Krishna Anusilanam Bhaktir Usume. Sri Rupa Goswami has said that devotion performed by the activities of the body, mind and word, as well as the cultivation of transcendental emotion performed for the happiness of Krishna, this is called Uttam Bhakti or pure devotion. So the intrinsic characteristics of this verse is Krishna Anusilanam Bhakti Usume. Anusilana means the cultivation. Some people think that bhakti should be simply devoid of envy towards Krishna, but this is not sufficient. For example, a tree, he may not hate Krishna, but it does not mean he is performing devotion. There was simply an absence of unfavorable emotions towards Krishna cannot be called bhakti. There must be some positive cultivation of activities for the happiness of Krishna. Therefore, Rupa Goswami has said, Anusilana. Hanu infers the idea that one should be performed under guidance of the spiritual master. Hanu also gives the idea of there must be a continuous flow. Not only once on the Sunday feast, once a week I perform bhakti, but 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, devotion should be formed in a continuous flow under the guidance of pure Vaishnava. For the happiness of whom? Not for the happiness of my wife or my children or any other living entity in this world. What to speak of even a powerful demigod like Brahma or Shiva, Rupa Goswami has rejected all these other objects of devotion and said Krishna Anusilanam. Even other incarnations like Narayan or Nrisingadev or Bhagavan Ramchandra or Mathuresh Krishna or Dwarkadish Krishna, all have been rejected. Rupa Goswami said that Krishna, only Swayam Bhagavan Pradhananda Sri Krishna, only he is to be served, he is the object of love. Therefore, Anusilanam has two divisions, Bhavarupa and Shastarupa. Shastarupa is of two divisions. One is in the stage of Sadhan Bhakti Bhajan, one is in the stage of power of bhakti. And then Anusaran also means the cultivation of devotional sentiments that is, that come after the stage of bhava bhakti. Also there is nivritti rup and pravritti rup. These activities performed that are favorable for devotion are also to be considered devotional, and also endeavors by which one tries to avoid non-devotional sentiments or activities, this is also to be considered a cultivation of devotion. For example, on a codicil we should not eat grains. Therefore, pravritti rup means for Krishna's happiness I am giving up grains on a codicil, and for Krishna's happiness, for Krishna's happiness I am also giving up grains on a codicil. Does that make sense? For Krishna's happiness I will follow a codicil, and for Krishna's happiness I will give up grains on a codicil. Therefore that is also to be considered chastarup endeavors. Therefore, activities should be performed not simply for the happiness of Krishna. Otherwise there could be an overextension of the definition or an underextension of the definition. For example, activities may be performed and Krishna may achieve happiness by those activities, but this may not be bhakti. The example given by Sri Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur is when Krishna entered the wrestling arena of Kams Maharaj. That time the wrestlers, Chalanamustik, they challenged Krishna. Oh, Krishna Balaram, you are servants of the king, Kamsa, therefore you should fight for his happiness. Therefore Krishna and Balaram tried to avoid. We are only small boys, and you guys are like mountains. This is not a fair fight. Then Chalanamustik said, no, we know that you are not ordinary boys, otherwise how you could kill big demons like Putana, Adasura and Bakasura. Therefore they grabbed Krishna and began trying to. They began fighting with him, head to head, shoulder to shoulder, arm to arm, knee to knee. They were dragging each other one side to another side. That time Krishna felt great happiness, because Krishna is one type of hero, the topmost hero. Therefore sometimes he also likes to engage in fighting. This is called Virup. But actually Chalanamustik, they are not performing their wrestling activities to give happiness to Krishna. They are performing their wrestling activities to kill Krishna. Therefore, even though Krishna felt happiness in fighting with Chalanamustik, we cannot say Chalanamustik were performing devotion despite Krishna's happiness. Because their mood was not to give happiness to Krishna, their mood was to try and kill him. Therefore, simply giving that Krishna may be happy by an activity may not in itself be an indication of pure devotion. There also may be an underextension of the definition. For example, Maria's daughter is tying Krishna to the grinding water and threatening to beat
blah blah, these type of things, which is not in itself pure devotion, Rupa Goswami has rejected by saying Anya Bila Sita Sunyam. Bhakti should be completely unmixed, it should be one-pointed and pure. Then one may say, then why Rupa Goswami has only said Anya Bila, what is the necessity for Anya Bila Sita? Therefore Rupa Goswami has said, sometimes a devotee, because he has no other recourse or there is some emergency, they may ask Krishna for some help. The example given of Draupadi, she was being stripped naked in the assembly of the Kurus, therefore she prayed, Rako Sadanam Apto Jivatohari. She raised her hands and prayed, Krishna, protect me. Therefore it may seem this is not devotion because she is praying to Krishna for something for herself, but Rupa Goswami said, because this is in an emergency situation, therefore some concession is given. For example, I'm about to be eaten by a tiger and I pray, oh Krishna, save me. Bhakti is not lost because it's an emergency. Life is in danger at that time. Also, bhakti should not be covered by jnana or karma. For example, we know there's many kirtan groups in America and around the world. They're also chanting Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. It may look like they're performing devotion, but their end goal is to become one with God, to merge with God. Therefore, this cannot be called devotion, because if you become one with God, you cannot serve Him. Therefore devotion is there, but it's covered by jnana, the desire for liberation. Therefore this has been rejected also. And someone also may go to the temple, especially on the day of lottery, then he's bought a lottery ticket. Instead of giving one stick of incense, he waves five sticks of incense to Krishna. Oh Krishna, if I win the lottery, I promise I'll give you half. Did I say half? I meant 10%. Therefore he is worshipping Krishna, he is performing service to Krishna, but his desire is his own material enjoyment. Therefore, Rupa Goswami has rejected both these things. But still, Rupa Goswami has said, anavrita, because one cannot live completely without knowledge, although some people manage it, some people cannot live completely without knowledge or without karma. For example, even breathing, even eating, even sitting, even sleeping, this is called karma. Therefore, the karma which is performed in a way which is favorable to Krishna. For example, I have to sleep, otherwise how I can go to Mangalati? If I cannot eat, then I cannot perform my devotion. Therefore, karma of eating does not cover devotion as long as it's performed in a way that is favorable towards the cultivation of devotion. Therefore, Rupa Goswami has given this and so much more that I have missed out. Anya bilasita sunyam jnana karma adidavatam anukulena krishna anushilanam bhaktir uttama.
Thank you. Bhutan Prabhu, they speak on this slope. Anya bilasita sunyam jnana karma adidavatam. In brief, what he told.
The brief part would be easy, I think.
I want that all time, then I will ask from ladies also to speak on this subject.
Om Jnana Timarandasya Gyananjana Savakaya Chakshura Nilitam Jnana Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha. I'm about to show how far I have to go in my devotion because I can't even hold a candle to Damodar Maharaj's exposition on the verse. But the main point that I've taken from Damodar Maharaj and from Srila Gurudev's discussions in the past on this topic is that devotional service has to be performed without any sense of personal aggrandizement, that one has to be completely dedicated to the object of devotion, and that one should not have any mixture in one's devotion for self-gain of any type, whether that's the acquisition of knowledge, which leads one to ultimately to liberation and personalist realization, or whether that's an even lower level of approaching Krishna for some material gain, these things are not accepted as pure bhakti. When we tinge our bhakti, when we tinge our practices with some hope for personal aggrandizement, we can never obtain the object of devotion, which our acharyas are telling us is the highest goal of life. Furthermore, after we examine ourselves and ask, is our bhakti pure? Is our intention pure in what we're doing? The next question is, are we actually performing that bhakti in an uninterrupted way? So are we starting and stopping? Are we waking up in the morning and doing our whatever number of rounds or malas that we do every day, and then when we are done with our mala, we put our bead bag down and forget Krishna or forget our Guru Seva? So everything that we do, whether it's some practical seva, some practical service for the Guru, serving the devotees, serving the holy name, serving the deity, whatever we do, we should try to cultivate within ourselves an uninterrupted flow where in our minds and our hearts we're constantly striving in a deep meditation for the attainment of our goal. The last thing that I'll be able to say today is that the ultimate goal of pure bhakti is the thing which gives all of these other things that we could possibly hope for and so much more. As Srila Gurudev said in the beginning of this class, that the highest goal, the highest love and affection, the pure love of God, the pure love of Radha and Krishna, the most intimate aspects of the Supreme Lord are attained by this this pure bhakti. That's it. Thank That's you. My humble offer.
Why not Anna Bilas Sunna? Why Anna Bilasita Sunna? Why? Oh, you can see it here and
why not
Allah Bilas Sunnam? But it has been told Anna Bilasita Sunnam.
It can mean
it all. What do you?
Anna Bilasita.
No. He could not give attention. You, Prabhu, yes.
Yang dengan dasar jalan dengan silakan. Sesudah dari kangjera, tas masih kita beri nama. So,
Rohan, you should be ready for next day.
But then you have to say what the question will be. Today you have to say what the question will be tomorrow.
Really, you should understand what meaning is. To practice. I want that all should practice knowingly.
Anya Abhilash means other desires. So the desire that is required is the desire to serve Krishna and please Krishna favorably. And Anya Abhilash means any desire other than that. Any fruitive desire for any karma performed for some material activity that's going to come. Or desire for jnana, desire for mystic siddhis, desire for merging into Brahman. So under Srila Gurudev's inspiration, Putipad Damodar Maharaj explained that if somebody has, generally they have no desire, but when an emergency arrives, then they may appeal to Krishna for help. Just like, for example, it is the duty of the devotee to protect his life, to protect his body. Like when when Devaki was being attacked by Kamsa. So it's explained that the devotee has to protect his life because his life is being used in the service of Krishna. So if some external agency comes and threatens the devotee's life, then it's okay to appeal to Krishna, oh, please help me, because otherwise how I can serve you. Then a life's to protect, it's okay. Otherwise if he doesn't, the devotee also, for example, Ambarish Maharaj, when he was confronted by Durvasa Muni, somehow or other, he became Rishi Maharaj, pulled out some of his dreadlocks, threw it on the ground, and this huge fiery demon came. So Ambarish Maharaj, actually he made him. It's not recorded that he made any appeal to Krishna. He just folded his hands and he waited. Oh, if Krishna wants to burn me up, it's okay. If he wants to come in the form of a demon, it's okay. Krishna didn't want. Chakra and Sudarshan Chakra burnt up the fiery demon. And then chased Durvasa Muni. But in any case, the devotee, he may appeal, but in any case, he accepts Krishna's decision. Okay, if you like to protect me, it's okay. Otherwise, it's okay. Kapilanod is saying, you can kill me, you can save me, as you like, because I'm a sold-out animal. Sold-out animal, any endeavor. He's just relying completely on the master. So but the tendency to have these desires. In the general run of things, the devotee does not have such desires. Only in the case of emergency he may have. Jnana, karmadi, and avritam. So, generally speaking, there's no need to engage in karma to improve our bhakti. Karma cannot improve. On the contrary, Srila Vishnu Chakravarti Thakur explains in Kadambani, Srila Gurudev was explaining during Kartik, that only when there is some mixture at least of bhakti, then can be successful, otherwise not. Similarly, only admixture of jnana, of bhakti, then jnana can be successful. Just like, for example, if somebody wants to get liberation, so they can practice for hundreds and thousands of lifetimes. But if they just chant the holy name by abha, like this, so jnana karmadhyaya. Avritam means covered. Unavrit, not covered. So actually we have to perform. Gurudev has explained, breathing is also karma. Now we're walking backwards and forwards between the hotel and here. This is karma. We have some money or somehow or other, get some finances together to come here. This is also karma. So does that mean that our bhakti has been covered? No. Anavritam, because the whole goal is to engage in devotional service. The whole goal is to hear from the lotus mouth, pure devotee. Therefore not avritam, it's anavritam. And jnana also. We have to have some knowledge. Oh, we must have knowledge. Like I said, somebody said that Aristotle said that the brain actually isn't used for thinking, for cooling the blood. But some modern commentator, he said, this is only true of some people. So in other words, actually we have to think, we have to have some knowledge. But if that knowledge is seen, then it's okay. The knowledge, for example, that Krishna is the Supreme Personality of Godhead, and the jiva is that this jnana is necessary. Not the knowledge that the individual jiva is actually God, or that he's actually part of Brahman. This is not necessary. But we have even this knowledge, Srila Rupa Goswami says, even this knowledge that Krishna is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Just like Srila Guru said, that your Swami Maharaj, he came to teach you that Krishna is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. And I come to teach you to forget that Krishna is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. But we also have to be careful, because you can't, according to linguistics, you can't forget in the first place. So if we artificially take Srila Gurudev's mood, Raj's mood, that Krishna is not the Supreme Personality of Godhead. You show them, I never think that Krishna is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. The gopis know. So if we artificially think, I'm Krishna, we don't care for Krishna, he's just a black, what do we care for Krishna? We just love Radha. This will not work. We should have tattva, just like it was explained this morning. First of all, we have tattva. If we don't have tattva, then we have to come back and learn tattva. And then by hearing from the lips of the pure devotee, his moods of loving service to Krishna in complete neglect of Krishna's Bhagavata, this will naturally sweep out these moods. Anukulyena. So, in Krishna. So what is Krishna feeling? He's feeling fear, but he's also feeling her love. Just like we have experience, sometimes we're traveling in Russia. So sometimes then the Russian devotees have to discipline us. Oh, now you have to take rest, exercise, now you have to do this, now you have to do that. Very strict, some of them are very strict. But in that strictness, you can feel, oh, there's love. Just like Krishna also, he likes to... This is the beauty of the left-wing gopis. When Krishna at Kurukshetra, he met with the gopis. The gopis hadn't seen him for so long. And instead of Krishna apologizing, he said, oh, I'm so sorry, I haven't been back to Vrindavan. How are you, like this? He started that, oh, why are you feeling separation from me? Don't you know I'm the Supreme Person of Godhead? Don't you know if you just meditate on my lotus feet, you don't feel any separation, don't you know this? And the right-wing gopis, they say, oh, very nice, thank you, we accept this. And the left-wing gopis, oh, we should engage in meditation on your lotus feet? We're trying to forget you. So strong, they're giving him the sword so strongly. Chastising like anything. And Krishna's feeling their love so much. So this is anukul. This is anukul. Krishna anusilana. And, Sripad Damodara Maharaj explained. So we have to make some effort, some endeavor. Not only physical endeavor. Srila Gurudev is emphasizing. Sometimes people members are distributing books, so many things. So I'm performing so much service. Go back home back to Godhead at the end of this lifetime. No, we have to also chesta. That difference between Kanishtha Adhikari, Madhyama Adhikari. Madhyama Adhikari is offering with mood. Kanishtha Adhikari is like offering chunks to Krishna, chunks of matter. He's offering prakriti. Krishna doesn't need our prakriti. He just needs He's got lovely incense, lovely fruit, lovely flowers, everything in the spiritual world. But he wants this mood from the heart. So this kind of anusilanam also is required. So there's so many questions.
Very good, that's blindness. My Siksha Guru, Srila Bhaktivedanta Swami Maharaj, came in Western countries and he told everywhere, Krishna is Supreme Lord. But I have come to say, forget this, the Lord. We should be Brajvasi and try to save this. Always he, Nandan, he is the servant of Brajvasi, all these. Then they called him in the lotus feet of gopis. How he is Supreme Lord? So we should try to forget forever and be one of the Brajvasi. Very good. Anukulena Krishna. What is an one of the oh he knows, she knows. Other. You stand up. No that. Oh you. Yes. Krishna Priya. No. Oh yes. Krishna Priya. Yes, sir. Big lumpa. Stand up. Then how you can preach my vision? How can you preach my vision? Anukulena. Understand what is the meaning. What do you mean by Anukulena?
That means everything that's favorable for bhakti. So Anukulena, we should reject everything that's unfavorable for bhakti.
Then why Anusilanam?
Anusilanam is like dedicating yourself to Krishna and offering everything and rejecting everything that's unfair for your bhakti.
Try to understand and preach my mission. All ladies, all my dear and brothers, they should know all this. Then you can preach, otherwise what? Book distribution. This will not do it. You will have to see what is the under the books. Then sit down. Now, we know from Srimad Bhagavatam that Dhruva Maharaj did astrologies. He took darshan of Narayan. His bhakti is pure or not? Jeev.
Om Jnanandasya Jnananjana Salakaya Chakshurum Vismay Shri Guruve Namah. First of all, I offer my respectful obeisances to my spiritual master, Vishnu Bhagavad-gita Narayan Maharaj, and then to all the Vaishnavas present here today. Srila Gurudev is asking that Dhruva Maharaj, he took direct darshan of Narayan. He got darshan of Krishna, Abad, but was his bhakti pure? does it fall under the category of this sloka that we've been discussing, Anya Bilasita Sunyam? If we understand a little bit about the history of Dhruvaj, he was a prince. And at that time, one of his dad can't sit on the lap of his father. Right? And he was very hurt by this. And because of this, he went into the forest and persisted for a very long time. And then eventually Narada Rishi gave him mantra. And he, by performing this, he got darshan of Narayan. But during the time of his practice, what he wanted was greater than his father. A kingdom that is greater than his father. This was, Gurudev explains in Mathura, Bhajane Bhavive Jaha Siddhite Paive Taha. Whatever you think of in the time of bhajan, whatever you're praying for, when you're practicing or creating your spiritual life, in perfection you will attain this. So when he took darshan of Narayan, he realized that what he was aspiring, he was looking for, was not worthwhile, it wasn't worth it. Right? He actually said, I was looking for broken pieces of glass and I found a diamond. But he didn't want this. But at the time of his practice of bhakti, of his sadhan, he is still in Dhruv Lok now. There. So the answer, of course, standing is no. His bhakti was not completely pure. It was not according to the sloka of Srila Rupa Goswami, Anya Bilasita Sunyam.
Okay.
Now, Dhruv Bhakti is not pure. It is called Sakam Bhakti, with worldly desire. Though he is disciple of Narada, by the grace of Narada, he took Vedanta. But he wanted, I should be the king of my father's property. He became the king. No? But at the departure from this world, when chariot Iman came for him to take, then he told, I will not go. I want that my mother should be with me. And then, your mother is going. You should come. And he went. So he received a position, not in that, but Hari Lok in this Brahmanda. Ramapriya Vaikuntha. Not in that.
Each of these devotees wants to show us something different. Draupadi, being one of the Pandavas, is on a higher level of bhakti than Prahlad Maharaj, because their worshipable deity is Lord Draupadish, who who is a more complete form of the Lord than Lord Nisimadeva. So the bhakti of Draupadi is higher. How is it that she prayed and Prahlad didn't pray? We have that verse that Shripad Damodara Maharaj quoted the last line, Anukulyena Krishna Anusilanam. Anusilanam means perpetually engaged for the glorification, pleasure, welfare of Krishna. Perpetually, just like a stream of honey falling from a jar, is not broken at any time. So their desire to please Krishna is not broken even at the time when there's danger. So how is that apparent contradiction there? Even when Draupadi prayed to Krishna to save her, this was for the glorification of Krishna. Krishna showed he was in Hastinapur, he was in Dwarka, and she was praying in Hastinapur, and she was trying to protect herself, and at the same time praying to Krishna. So Krishna was running around his palace, and his queen said, "Where are you running around in circles?" He said, "Well, my devotee Draupadi is praying to me." And they said, "Why don't you go?" So he said, "She's not fully surrendered yet." And then as soon as she lifted both arms and prayed, "If you like, you can save me," then even without his shoes, he ran because she had full dependence. So it's not that Draupadi has any less bhakti. She did it for Krishna's glorification. That's the only desire of all the devotees. Similarly, Prahlad Maharaj, all of his activities are for the glorification of Krishna. And therefore, he didn't pray to Krishna, knowing that Krishna would protect him, having that full dependence. So why is it said that the bhakti of Prahlad Maharaj, who is in prema bhakti, he's situated in prema bhakti, he's a Mahabhagavat, and his slokas, his verses of explanation of Krishna's glory are quoted by all great spiritual masters. In all of Srila Gurudev's tours, in every single country, he has the devotees discuss the teachings of Prahlad Maharaj to his father. He has them discuss the teachings of Prahlad Maharaj to his friends, glorifying the worship of the pure devotee, explaining how even by one's intelligence, even by the collective intelligence of others, without devotional service, one is simply engaged in the matter of chewing the chews. Prahlad Maharaj is the one who explained that one should protect his life by putting all over his body, smearing his body with the dust from the lotus feet of pure devotees who are completely free from all desires. Even when Prahlad Maharaj grew up, still his glories are broadcast all over the world. We hear about the success of Bali Maharaj. That success of Bali Maharaj is there due to Prahlad Maharaj's love to the Lord. Therefore, the Lord showed mercy to Bali Maharaj. Even when Prahlad Maharaj became a king, the Lord was so kind, showing the greatness of Prahlad. Prahlad Maharaj was the king, and it's the king's duty to establish the principles of Varnashram and to make sure that all the Varnas and Ashrams are performing their duties properly. A king should act like a king, a Brahmin should act like a Brahmin, and it's the king's duty to make sure of this. So once he saw a Brahmin, but this Brahmin had weapons, so he challenged him. "Are you a Brahmin or are you a Kshatriya? Make up your mind. You have to do one duty and do it properly. And if you don't follow my instructions and follow one particular dharma, then I'm ready to challenge you to fight." So he had a fight with this who knows Brahmin or who knows Kshatriya. And in the middle of this, he wasn't winning and this Brahmin or Kshatriya wasn't winning. And then he realized that nobody can defeat me in battle except the Lord. So he did some meditation in trance and understood that this must be my very Lord Nisringadev. And he thought it was a garland on this Lord Nisringadev, the garland that he himself had offered to his deity that morning. So he surrendered to the Lord, and the Lord said, no, you have actually defeated me. So Prahlad Maharaj's glories are sung all over the universe. But what kind of bhakti, because as Sri Padamadhar Maharaj is explaining, Anyadi Latika Sunyam Janakramadhyam Navratam, one's bhakti should not be covered by personal desires and by jnan or by karma. So, of course, some kind of jnan, he explained, must be there. I have to know that if I cross the street and a car is coming, I'll be killed. So jnan must be there, but it can't cover bhakti. So, Prahlad Maharaj is a jnani bhakta. That means he has knowledge or awareness of the supremacy of Lord Nisringadev. He, in his very, very famous prayer, Shravanam Kirtanam Vishnu, Smaranam Padasevanam, he uttered the word Vishnu. He knew that Lord Nisringadev is Vishnu, and he's a worshipper of Lord Vishnu. And because of that, when Lord Nisringadev appeared to him, he didn't think that, well, perhaps my Lord is thirsty or sweaty from killing my father, maybe I should wipe the perspiration off his face or offer him a drink of water. He didn't think like that because he knows my Lord is everywhere. He's all-pervading and he's all-powerful. Therefore, there's no hunger or thirst in him. There's no need for me to render personal service to him. He engaged in service of glorifying, but no personal service. This means that his bhakti was somewhat covered by jnana, not speculative jnana, not like a jnani that God is impersonal, but thinking that or knowing that he's the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Therefore, his pure uttama bhakti was covered by his knowledge that Krishna is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. And therefore, there are greater and greater bhaktas like Uddhava and the Pandavas, and ultimately, beyond even bhakti, beyond these bhaktas is the residents of Vrindavan who are fully engaged in his personal service, not at all knowing that he's the Supreme Lord.
Thank you. Gopalab Maharaj, pure bhakta, bhakjani bhakta. His bhakti is mixed with aishwarya jnana. So whether he don't want any worldly desire, but anukulena sevanam, he thinks that my Supreme Lord is everywhere, very powerful, he is the father of world, creator of the world. He never tires, so no use of necessity. Oh, he never hungry, thirsty. So like Draupadi, he used to cook for Krishna, and Krishna used to take. So he some aspect of Krishna. So Prahlad Maharaj is Siddha Bhakta. But Amrish Maharaj, not Siddha Bhakta, but he is superior in bhakti. How you increase? You could understand the graduation of bhakti.
Omajanatinirandasya jhanam janashalakaya chakshurunivalitam jena tasmai sri gurudeva namaha. So in the discussion, the gradual progression of bhakti and its stages of increasing purity, now we come to the understanding of Ambarish Maharaj, who is a Siddha Bhakta. He is actually following purely this verse that Srila Gurudev is having us study, Anyabhilashita Shunyam Jnana Karma Adhyanavritam Anakul Yena Krishnanushilanam Bhaktir Uttama. Sri Ambarish Maharaj, he was a great emperor thousands of years ago, living in Mathura. And the story is delineated of the history of Ambarish Maharaj and Durvasa Rishi, how Durvasa Rishi attempted to kill Ambarish Maharaj. We heard that described before. And the Sudarshan Chakra of Lord Narayan was sent to protect Ambarish Maharaj. So, Ambarish Maharaj, what was his standard of worship of Krishna? Actually, Savaimana Krishna Padara Vindayor, Vachamsi Vaikuntha Gunani Varanane. Ambarish Maharaj utilized every single one of his senses in the service of Krishna in a very practical way. He was constantly thinking of Krishna 24 hours daily. Savai Mana Krishna Padara Vindayor. His mind was absorbed in the lotus feet of Krishna. Vachamsi Vaikuntha Gunanu Varanane. His tongue was utilized in constantly glorifying and describing the activities of Krishna. And all of his limbs of his body were also utilized. Sometimes he would be utilizing his feet to go traveling and walking on pilgrimage to the holy places where Krishna performed his pastimes. Sometimes he was utilizing his arms, even in cleansing the temple of Krishna, personally cleansing Krishna's temple. Although he was a great emperor, he did not employ someone else to do this, because if you employ someone else to do the bhakti in your temple, that does not mean that you are performing bhakti. So he personally did this worship of the Lord. His eyes were utilized in seeing the very beautiful deity forms of Krishna in the temple. His ears were utilized in hearing the glorification of the Lord. His nose was utilized in smelling the beautiful fragrance, sweet fragrance of the flowers and tulsi offered to the lotus feet of Krishna. So like this, all of his senses, his mind, his intelligence, everything was completely absorbed in Krishna 24 hours daily without any other ulterior motive. Only what has been described, anakulyena Krishna anushilanam. 24 hours daily, under the guidance of his guru and Vaishnavas, he was constantly absorbed in serving Krishna for Krishna's pleasure and happiness. So Maharaj Ambarish, he was fully absorbed in Krishna. It is stated, Savaimana Krishna Padara Vindayo. Krishna was his worshipable Lord, his Ishtadev. And he was also living. Where was he living? In Mathura, the eternal abode of Krishna, the transcendental holy dham of the Supreme Lord. So Ambarish Maharaj, he was protected by the Supreme Lord when someone tried to attack him, and as was described, he was unmoved by this. He was not disturbed, he was not fearful, because his whole consciousness, all of his desires were completely merged with the will of the Supreme Lord. Therefore, if Krishna wants to kill me, I accept that. If Krishna wants to protect me, let it be. So this was Maharaj Ambarish's move. And therefore, when Durvasa Rishi came to see, finally, first of all, he approached for protection to Lord Brahma, then to Lord Shiva. Both of them told him, I cannot protect you. The Sudarshan Chakra is coming from Lord Narayan. You have to go there yourself. And then at that time, he finally went and approached Lord Narayan directly. And what did Lord Narayan say to him? He said, actually, my bhakta is my very heart and soul, and I am not independent of my bhakta. So, my bhakta is always absorbed in thinking of me, and I am completely absorbed in thinking of him. In this way, Lord Narayan told Durvasa Rishi, you must go to the lotus feet of Maharaj Ambarish, and there you will have to fall at his feet and beg forgiveness. So this is what Guru Maharaj Rishi did. He came there, traveling back again, and fell at the lotus feet of Ambarish. Ambarish Maharaj, during the time that Durvasa Rishi was traveling throughout the universe, Ambarish Maharaj did not even break his fast of Ekadasi. He stayed put in that same place, and constantly he was praying to the Sudarshan Chakra of the Lord. And it was because of this reason that the Sudarshan Chakra did not finally kill Durvasa Rishi. So when Durvasa Rishi came and fell at the lotus feet of Ambarish Maharaj, then Ambarish Maharaj prayed directly to Sudarshan Chakra, and he was appeased, and then he left that place. And then, Durvasa Rishi, he was so deeply moved by witnessing this great quality of the pure devotee. He said, Oho Ananta Dasa Anam, now I have seen today with my very own eyes the greatness of the servants of the Supreme Lord, who is known as Ananta, the Supreme Unlimited Lord. Now I have seen that even though I wanted to kill him, he only wanted my benefit. So Maharaj Ambarish was glorified in this way by Durvasa Rishi, and this story in Srimad Bhagavatam is showing us the superior position of Ambarish Maharaj even to that of Prahlad Maharaj. Although Prahlad Maharaj is a Siddha, he's a perfected personality. He has fully realized the Supreme Lord, and he was protected directly by Lord Nisringadev. Lord Nisringadev personally appeared to protect him. So he is not a sadhaka who is only practicing to attain perfection, but he has actually attained that stage. But Ambarish Maharaj, still he is in the level of sadhaka, that he is performing sadhana. Sadhana means spiritual practices to attain perfection, siddha. But yet, Ambarish Maharaj's position is considered superior to that of Prahlad Maharaj. Why? Because as has been described, Prahlad Maharaj had some mixture of jnana, knowledge about the Supreme Lord. That knowledge is not a covering of his bhakti, as has been described, jnana karma vyanavritam. The knowledge did not cover his bhakti, because he was not on the material level. He was pure and transcendental, no material desires, only desires to please the Supreme Lord. But his conception of the Supreme Lord and how to please him and how to serve him was not as high as that of Ambarish Maharaj, because he had jnana mishra. He realized the supreme aishwarya of the Supreme Lord, that he is everywhere. He knows everything. He is eternal. He has no material body. He does not need to eat, to drink, or anything. He has no material needs. And in this way, being absorbed in this transcendental knowledge of the Supreme Lord, his bhakti was somewhat weakened by this knowledge. Therefore, he did not perform any personal services to the Lord, like we hear about Ambarish Maharaj personally serving the deity form of the Lord in the temple and using all of his senses to do so many services. So that's why Ambarish Maharaj is considered a superior position to Prahlad Maharaj, because of the type of bhakti that he was performing. It is more intimate, and it is directed towards Krishna in Braja, in Vrindavan. His Ishtadev is also of a superior position to that of Prahlad Maharaj, who is worshipping Vaikuntha Narayan. So like this, Srila Gurudev is explaining to us that we must understand the gradations of bhakti. First, we have to understand what is Uttam Bhakti, the definition of that which we have studied today in so many different ways. So many speakers have described all the details of that verse written by Rupa Goswami. We must understand, because if we do not perform Uttam Bhakti, pure bhakti, then we will not receive the result. Only by Uttam Bhakti, as it is stated, Srila Gurudev stated in the first verse that he quoted today from Srimad Bhagavatam, Savai Pumsan Paro Dharmo, Yato Bhaktir Adhokshaje, Ahoyshuti Apratihata, Ye Atma Samprasidati. Atma Samprasidati means that the Supreme Lord, the Supreme Paramatma, he will be completely satisfied. only when Krishna is completely satisfied by one's bhakti can it be considered uttam bhakti, topmost, pure bhakti. So in this way, by studying the gradations of bhaktas and understanding their corresponding levels and qualities and services and moods, then we can understand this differentiation. And then when we study, as Gurudev is leading us, ultimately to understand the highest bhakti of the Vishvasis, who have completely no knowledge that Krishna is the Supreme Lord. They love him only as their dear most friend, their dear most child, their dear most beloved. And in this way, their bhakti is the very, very topmost type of uttam bhakti. So in this way, by the mercy of Srila Gurudev, and by the mercy of all of our Vaishnava Sarjas, especially Srila Sanatana Goswami, who all of this discussion is based upon his Brihat Bhagavatamritam, which Srila Gurudev has lectured on many, many times in his tours, we begin to understand this process of attaining Shuddha Bhakti, pure bhakti.
Now, just to be ready, come up. But you should stand up and you should do the creation by your leg. I told you yesterday that you should be ready. Okay, but then tomorrow. Just to take it. And Manjari is here. Manjari. Where is Manjari? Manjari should come here. Right away. Then you. Then Kirtan. Durgam. Hari Hari, Sitale Janama Gomal. Sitale Janama Gomal. And that would be ready.
Thank you.
project one.
Rama play should start immediately. Before we start the play, I'd like to say,
we'd like to welcome all the devotees
from all over the world.
They've come from South America, Mexico, all over the United States, all over Europe, Russia. And we've assembled for one reason, and that is to celebrate the appearance of our beloved Gurudev. Can I get a Jai Gurudev? Can I get a Jai Gurudev? This is the most blessed event. Without this day, where would we be? This morning, Prabhu Samarani gave a beautiful class, followed by Damodar's class. Tomorrow, Pujapad Madhav Maharaj will be giving a class at 7 a.m. and you will have a very special message from Gurudev. We want all to come. 7 a.m. tomorrow morning. So they should be here at 7. You'll be here for that. All right, you go.
Where the Supreme Personality of Godhead in his original threefold living form of Krishna, Bhagavan Buddha, eternally engages in loving pastimes with his most intimate devotees. Krishna also presides over the Vaikuntha class, but not in his original form. He expands himself into his four-armed form, known as the Lion or Vishnu. Thus, he presides over all the Vaikuntha planets. Once, on one of these blissful Vaikuntha planets, two gatekeepers of the Lion, known as Jai and Jiva, were pondering how they could better serve the Lord. Stop! Not that anyone can enter the palace of Lord Narayana. air, fire, water, and earth. But still, they reach this material universe. It is night. And the wind is howling from the sky. Blood and pus are falling. The whole planet is shaking with earthquakes. It is causing the ground to crack open. This night, the terrible genius, he renders Hashimoto being born. From his very birth, we renders Hashimoto was a great genius who wanted more material wealth and power than anyone else. For 125 years, he performed severe austerity by standing on the tip of his toes. He became more and more powerful until it looked as if he would destroy the entire universe. Finally, the demigods begged Lord Brahma to come down to Earth and stop him from creating further destruction.
Oh, son of Kachapamuni, please get up. I am so much astonished to see your endurance, in spite of being bitten and eaten by so many worms and ants. Your light air is circulating within your bones. Certainly this is so wonderful. Now even saintly persons like Drayton, who were born previously, they could not perform such severe austerity. Who within the TV world could perform such austerity? Who could sustain their life hundreds of years without even drinking water? Your austerity, your performance of austerity has now become perfect. Come here, Rani Kashyapu. Please get up. You may now ask for me any benediction. Oh, my Lord. Oh, original personality within this universe, Lord Brahma. You are fully cognizant and can apply your mind and realize intelligence in the creation of this cosmic manifestation. You are beginningless, endless, omniscient, and beyond the limits of space and time. Oh my Lord, oh best of the givers of benedictions, if you would kindly grant me the benediction that I desire, then let me not meet death from any of the living entities created by you. Granted. Then grant me this, that I may not be killed on the ground or in the sky. That's all right. Then grant me this, that I may not be killed during the day or during the night. I comply. Then grant me this, that I may not be killed inside or outside. Of course, that's all right. Then grant me this, that I may not be killed by a man or beast. That's all right. And grant me this, that I may not be killed by any weapon. Of course, that's all right. Grant me this. I want sole dominion over all living entities and their presiding deities. I want all the glory that comes from this position. Furthermore, want all this power for humanity to not be lost at any time. Oh, Gaudiya Kashi Guru, these transitions that you ask for are impossible to be had by most every man. My dear son, Gaudiya Kashi Guru, right now, you will be the one. I'm going to grant you a boon. I'm going to fulfill your wish. Oh, thank you! Ha 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 ha! Now I'm immortal! I'm immortal! Death! Close your portal! I hear any of and now everyone worship me. You must come from outside. There you will be protected. You can remain there.